Good morning, everybody. You're back at it for another day at the WTO Public Forum. I'm Rick Sammons, member of the Managing Board of the World Economic Forum. Very happy to be here with you today for this Enabling Sustainable Investment for Inclusive Growth session, which is held under the rubric of our E15 initiative, which is a partnership with our colleagues at the International Center for Trade and Sustainable Development. I know that was probably blindingly obvious to you when you walked in the room, since there was a lot of literature out there in this regard. But today we're going to focus in one particular area that was covered by this E15 initiative, and that is sustainable investment and what can be done to, particularly on the facilitation side, to boost the engagement of developing countries and boost the benefits, broaden the benefits from foreign direct investment in those countries widely throughout their societies. Just a word or two about the E15, if you're not familiar with it. This has been a couple-year strategic thought process, a multi-stakeholder engagement of the private sector, academic, former government, and other experts to think about how the rules, disciplines, and institutional arrangements broadly within the international system should evolve over the next 10 years or so to better align with the changes in the world economy and with the changes, frankly, in the political landscape of the international community as well, in order to foster sustainable development and broad-based progress in living standards, which, after all, is the final objective of any kind of economic policy instrument, let alone a trade policy per se. This is an exercise that was done, co-convened by our two institutions, the World Economic Forum and ICTSD, but it really was a grand partnership. There were 16 partner institutes around the world involved in helping to facilitate and pull together these discussions. They engaged about 375 or so experts of different types. In 80 different dialogues, about 150 papers were published to develop this through 18 different topics and specific policy option papers were developed by those 18 different groups. We, in January of earlier this year, put out the report, which was not only these individual policy option papers from the 17 or 18 different groups, but also a synthesis, an executive summary and a synthesis, which are both available outside in the front. Now, on the topic of investment, which I have to say was arguably the most treated topic across, if I think about it, across the entire domain of work, there was quite a bit of interest, and you'll see some proposals, which I'll just briefly summarize here, spanning from trying to build a better framework, normative framework, for investment by looking not only at a reconsideration and an integration or convergence of obligations on the state, on the host state side, but also on the investor side, as well as a suggestion that there be a process that builds up from a model agreement, a more modern type of agreement, and to try to get a dialogue going in which various parties would begin to coordinate the features of their investment agreements so that we declutter the spaghetti bowl landscape of 3,200 or 300 different investment agreements out there into something that's a bit more coherent and therefore easier to operate across for companies who are having to operate in many, many different jurisdictions under different regimes, but also to modernize that, as I just indicated, by infusing this evolving, converging body of a more coherent investment normative framework with a better understanding of a sustainable development, a better understanding of what investor obligations should be as well as investor obligations, a better cooperative basis for supporting developing countries in finding partners, investment partners, adjudicating disputes, having better legal advice at a reasonable or pro bono rate to do so. So there's a wealth of different aspects of proposals in this E15 body of work for trying to modernize and make much more helpful for inclusive growth the investment, foreign direct investment landscape out there. Today, we're going to particularly focus on the facilitation aspects, but others as well. I certainly invite our distinguished group to talk about that. The basic questions before our group are, what is the status of sustainable development principles inclusion into investment agreements? How well are these reflected? What are the opportunities to make improvements in that regard? How to increase the flow of sustainable investment, particularly to poorer countries? And is there a role for the WTO in facilitating such flows? And what can the public and private sectors do to encourage and monitor global value chain practices that are responsible, that engage in responsible sourcing practices? This is a very dynamic and evolving body of activity in the world economy. And so this morning, I think we're really lucky to have some people who've been right involved in the heart of this matter from interestingly different perspectives. We have Ambassador Alvaro Cedeño Molinari, who's permanent rep of Costa Rica to the WTO here. He's going to lead us off. Kruti Indani, who's group director of Indani Global. Ratnakar Adhikari, executive director of the Enhanced and Integrated Framework, which is part of the executive secretariat here at the WTO. Gita Rollins, who's head of Multinational Enterprises and Enterprise Engagement Unit at the International Labor Organization, and Marcela Manubens, who's Vice President for Social Impact at Unilever. So you can see, I think we've got, I thank my colleagues, because I think we've assembled a great combination of perspectives to treat the subject today. The format will simply be to offer each of these distinguished thinkers and actors 7 or 8 minutes to offer their perspective on the matter. And then the idea really is to engage you in a discussion in the audience with our people up here today. So with that, let me invite you, Ambassador Molinari, to lead us off.
Thank you very much, Richard, and good morning to everyone. Thank you for being here. I can't believe it's Thursday already. What a fast week it has been. And I want to focus my few minutes talking about Costa Rica as a case study for sustainable investment. We have transitioned in the course of a generation from being an agricultural-based economy into a knowledge-based economy. And in that regard, I guess there are some best practices that we could share, especially among developing countries, which is one of our core interests here at the WTO as well. And at the outset, allow me to introduce a concept that illustrates the trajectory that Costa Rica has had the last 30 years. And it is the concept of regenerative development. We are used to hearing about sustainable development, but we believe that we have accomplished something a little bit different. In this period of time, since the early 80s until today, our economy, our GDP, has expanded 3 times, so we have tripled our GDP. And in the same period of time, our forest coverage has doubled. So this is usually counterintuitive, because we associate economic growth with some environmental costs. But in our case, economic growth has been simultaneous to ecological expansion. And this has been a virtuous cycle, or a virtuous spiral, that has allowed us to invest on infrastructure for tourism attraction, for example. So we focused on the service of ecological tourism, and then it became clear to us that ecological expansion was a good business in the strict sense of the word. Now, as we expanded ecologically, we also worked on transforming our public policy so that we would reduce transaction costs for domestic companies, but also foreign companies, to look at Costa Rica in a different way, to install themselves in the country, to manufacture their goods, and to make it easier for them to access their markets abroad. And as some of you may know, in the 90s, as we were launching our public policy framework on sustainable development, we managed to secure the investment of an Intel manufacturing plant in Costa Rica, which caused a ripple effect throughout an industry that we didn't have at the time, and attracted and created new suppliers for Intel in Costa Rica so that they would more easily, with lower transaction costs, manufacture and export. At the height of Intel manufacturing in Costa Rica, they were exporting 99% of all computer servers, microchips that were used worldwide. So it was really significant what this cost to the country. It basically created a new cluster of dozens of companies, some of them that came following Intel, others that were created precisely to supply Intel domestically. And 2 years ago, Intel made a decision to remove the manufacturing plant from Costa Rica and relocate it in East Asia so that they would have most of their manufacturing in the same time zone, so to speak. And what they left in Costa Rica was a laboratory for innovation, which was an experimental project that they started last decade, 10 years ago, in which they took a group of Costa Rican engineers, they trained them in innovation in their facility in Arizona. And when these engineers came back to Costa Rica with the training on innovation, they started creating microprocessors that were, well, pretty much innovative. I don't know if you remember the Itanium processor that came out a few years ago. At the time when the Itanium came out, it was 8 times more energy efficient than any other microprocessor that Intel had at the time. And this was created in Costa Rica by Costa Ricans. So this was a very illustrative example for Intel and for Costa Rica of what we could achieve. So 2 years ago, when Intel decided to leave their manufacturing, or take their manufacturing to Asia and leave innovation lab in Costa Rica, well, there was a little bit of concern about it, but in my personal view, it was very good news because it was clear for Intel that the greatest value that they could obtain in the country was not in manufacturing itself. They could do that elsewhere, but in innovation. So this is, at the time, generating, as we speak, generating a new cluster of innovation and suppliers for the kind of innovation that Intel and other companies need to do. Intel is not the only success story that we have in terms of investment. There is a significant cluster of medical devices that are also, after 20 odd years of investing and manufacturing and exporting from Costa Rica, starting to innovate in Costa Rica. So this is a very exciting story, and as we see it unfold. Now, another important element in this process is that we have managed to link our local and foreign industry in Costa Rica to global value chains. So this has allowed us to understand the reach of the workforce that we have and how education can transform a Costa Rican student from pretty much anywhere in the country into a technician or an engineer or a supplier or a service provider of a company that is having an end product or an end service in the global market economy. So in that regard, we have managed to create a scenario or an infrastructure in which the reach of investment in Costa Rica has a wide access to our public education, public universities, our public schools, as well as there is a lot of local impact of these investments in the country. Then obviously I am also referring to SMEs or to MISMEs, as there are several cases of very small Costa Rican companies of 15 or 20 employees that are developing software that larger companies are purchasing or using in a global value chain scenario as well. Now we see into the future that there is that there are some low hanging fruits, mainly in the area of clean energy. the fact that we already generate 100% of our electricity from renewable sources means that whatever we manufacture in Costa Rica today is manufactured with a very low carbon footprint. So if we want to manufacture technology for renewable energy generation, then we can also manufacture it in Costa Rica without emitting carbon emissions in the process. And just to finish up with a linkage of this story that I have told with the WTO, the Intel story that I shared with you would not have been possible if we would not have signed into the Information Technology Agreement, the ITA, back in 1996. This allowed us to attract a company like Intel to start this snowball effect that has been developed. And as we speak, we are negotiating the Environmental Goods Agreement, the EGA, which we believe will be a trade policy tool that will allow us to create a new cluster in an area in which we today have no experience. We don't have manufacturing pretty much of environmental goods, but we do believe that we can replicate the exercise or the experience that we gained with the ITA with the EGA for the next 20 or 25 years. Okay, I think I'll leave it up to that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks for getting us going with a really concrete illustration. Now over to you, Kruti Indani. Just maybe invite you to talk about how relevant the existing legal framework is for companies that are interested in investing, but also facilitating sustainable development. I say that with some degree of interest because we in ICTSD, with the support of the government of the Netherlands, are going to be conducting over the next several months or so, a year plus, a dialogue process to have a discussion among various parties, developed and developing countries, about how common ground can be expanded on the framework to incorporate some of the perspectives and considerations I mentioned in my opening comments. So it'd be interesting to hear, since you've been active in this space, what your view is in this, as well as in how one might think about promoting inclusive value chains.
Thank you, Richard. Obviously, I am representing the business community. Our company has been investing in different countries. We've been investing in Ukraine, in India, in Singapore, and recently in Colombia. For sustainable investment in developing markets or emerging markets, what is very important is the policy of the country and the legal framework which guides the policy of the country. We have had a positive and a negative the impression of the countries and where we have been investing at the moment. In any country, what is very important is the legal framework and the policy of the country should be very transparent. It should be easily accessible to all the investors. There should be less of hurdles, less of barriers. Policy of the country should also make provision for protection of intellectual property rights. It should protect the interests of the investors while investing in land, while protecting their property rights, their ownership rights. The policy of the country should also make provision for trade incentives. What is very important is any country, which especially the developing countries and the emerging markets today are inviting a lot of investors to come into their countries. So what is very important here is the investment policy of the country. So what kind of incentives is the country giving the investors while they enter these particular countries? What is the trade policy of the country? The trade policy of the country would also address the costs and the compliances involved in customs and other administrative bodies in cross-country trade. The third aspect that we would look into would be what are the investment promotion bodies' involvements in that particular country. So we have, in most of countries, what you call the investment promotion associations or the IPAs. So exactly how well are these IPAs funded? How are these IPAs interacting with us investors? How well informed are they about regional as well as international investment policies? We are looking here at domestic investments as well as international investments going to each country. And apart from this, we also need to understand what are the tax incentives of the country. Because this, at the end of the day, an investor, whether it is a private sector or a public sector, would obviously look at the economic viability of the project and to what extent are the policies of the country and the incentives being provided by the country and the tax regime of the country, to what extent is it affecting the and at what extent would it contribute to the economic viability of the project. Obviously, we also look into other factors like corporate governance. We look at HRD, and HRD is a very, very neglected area. It's a very underfunded area, whereas I personally feel that we need a very skilled, capable workforce to bring in the latest technology. It's a very fast-expanding world, and we need a very, very well-equipped, skilled workforce. I can obviously talk about a few issues that my company personally has faced. We have, as I had mentioned, we have invested in three countries, and the fourth we've just started investing. We have invested in two gold refineries in India. We have an operational refinery in the northern part of India, and the second refinery, which would be the largest refinery in India, would be ready in March, April. However, until 2013, India was not importing raw gold. India did not have refineries. India today, along with China, is the largest importer of gold. But India was importing bullion, and India India had a few refineries, but not well equipped enough to refine gold because it was not economically viable. In order to encourage the Make in India concept, and in order to bring in more investment into the country, and gold is the second largest import bill of India, which is about 58 billion. The Central Bank of India, which is the Reserve Bank of India, would like to put a cap of 38 billion on the import of gold. Because of which, in 2013, the government of India reduced the import duty on raw gold, which is dore, as compared to that of bullion. The differential, the arbitrage, was about 2%. The import duty on bullion was 10%, and that on raw gold or dore was 8%. In 2014, there was a new government. So political stability is very important. And what is very important is for any government, even if there's a change in government, the policies should follow. A lot of capital investment has been made by most of the companies which have set up the refineries. Either today, backward integration and forward integration is very important. So for the companies which have set up the refineries, these companies have invested in mines. And when you invest in mines, you have to have an offtake agreement, which you have to honor because there is a legal contractual obligation. In 2014, there were a lot of refineries which came up because of the encouragement that was being given with the arbitrage in import duty. In 2016, very surprisingly, during the budget of 2016, the government reduced the import, they increased the import duty on dore from 8 to 8.75, reducing the arbitrage to 1.25% from 2%. So this has created an impact on the refineries. If this year, starting from April to August, there were hardly any imports into India. The government organization MMTC with PAMP, a Swiss company, has hardly refined any gold this year, along with the rest of the refineries. And the main reason being the policy of the country has changed. Now, what I personally feel is when there has been a certain policy based on which a company has invested into a country, so the policy cannot change immediately until and unless a certain duration of time is given for the investors to think of a backup plan or to structure and formulate the business accordingly. So this is one big bottleneck that we have faced. And we still face the issue in which the government had earlier encouraged import of raw gold. And today, the government feels that it is not good for the public to divert most of the investment into gold when they should be investing into infrastructure, which is a core area. However, what about the investors who've already invested? What about the investors who already have long-term contract supplies with mines? So this is an issue that we face in case there are mercurial policy changes, in case there's a volatile political environment, and which I personally feel is something that needs to be looked into. A very positive environment for investment, I would say, has been Dubai. Dubai, for me, has been one country which, for me as an investor, has been very consistent in the policies. In 1994, 1995, when JAFSA opened up to the rest of the world, the same policies which were implemented by the Dubai government are what are continuing even today. So it was a free zone. There was a zero tax incentive which interested all the investors. A lot of investors moved into Dubai. And that is the success story of Dubai. There's been no change in the policy of the country. So people continue to live in Dubai. And Dubai has grown from a desert. Dubai has grown to what it is today because of the encouragement it has given, the incentives that were provided to the investors, which have remained consistent throughout. So it is very important that the incentives which are being provided or any policy provisions which are being provided in order to attract investors has to remain consistent in order to sustain the investment. Because here we are talking about sustainable investment. In order for any investment to be sustainable, the basic policies which have been in place when any investment is being made into a certain project have to be in place for a minimum of 10 years at least. I do understand that the government attitude and policies could change depending upon the economic situation and the changing scenario of the world. However, I personally feel that the policy changes should, which have been initially been put in place, have to continue over a certain duration of time in order to make the investment of the investors who have come in with full faith to be sustainable over a long duration of time.
Very good. Thanks very much. You've given us a very concrete illustration of how one aspect of sustainability, the sustainability of the legal framework, is quite an important condition for investment to flow and to remain. Now, Mr. Adhikari, we're interested to hear a perspective, particularly about developing countries, how they perceive this, what kind of capacity building can be useful in this regard, how is the enhanced and integrated framework set up to support. Over to you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Richard. And I would also like to thank the organizer for providing me this opportunity. I will try to respond to your questions, particularly from the perspective of LDCs, least developed countries, where we are actively working. We are working in 51 countries right now, and they include 48 least developed countries and 3 recently graduated countries. We live in SDGs world. I mean, this is something that that has changed the mindset of policymakers and academics to some extent, but more changes are required in order to make investment sustainable, right? So what I would like to do is to define investment a bit broadly, you know, not only private investment, even public investment is important, because when we are talking about public goods, it is either the government or development partners or private sector provide resources for public investment. The idea of public investment is, of course, to help countries achieve sustainable development goals, such as health, education, infrastructure, and what have you. But at the same time, the idea is to crowd in private investment, right? And in order to crowd in private investment that are essentially aimed at producing private goods is going to be very, very important, but at the same time, the public investment has a role to play there as well. Both investment can be pro-poor and inclusive, although the motives can be different, initial motives can be different. The idea is how to set up a policy regime globally, regionally, as well as at the national level, in order to induce more private investment into the sectors that would eventually contribute to the achievement of sustainable development goal. Because here, I want to bring a fact to your attention that it is impossible for only private public investment to help these countries achieve sustainable development goal. And particularly in the context of the least developed countries where we work, you know, they have several problems, including the resource constraint. Therefore, they will not be in a position to achieve the sustainable development goal. They will not be in a position to meet the resource gap that is necessary to be filled in order to achieve the sustainable development goal. Talking about private investment, you know, some of the investment that are made into sectors such as road, bridges, ports, telecom, finance, they can be very much instrumental in helping countries to achieve sustainable development goal. And this is something that we have to keep in mind. And the relevance of the policy, when we are talking about the policy, the legal environment and everything, you know, what we have to keep in mind, and I fully agree with Kruti when she said that, you know, they have to be fair, they have to be predictable, they have to be transparent, they have to be non-discriminatory. You cannot have one policy for a foreign investor and another policy for the local investors. You know, they have to be, to the extent possible, to the extent committed within the WTO framework as a part of the MoRE 3 of the GATS agreement, they have to be non-discriminatory in nature. Although the government will have the flexibility, and this is where, you know, we have a dilemma, and this is something that I want to get you, get the feedback from everybody on. So what policy dilemma that we face is that there was a almost for 20, 30 years we talked about promoting investment. Investment doesn't have a color. Investment does not have any baggage. Investment, wherever it comes from, in whatever form, would contribute to the economic development. Therefore, it is vital for the countries to attract investment. And most of the policies made in the past 30 years have been directed towards achieving this objective. Now, in the SDGs era, we are in a situation where we are now saying that investment, good, investment can be good or bad. But at the same time, it is important for the governments to have the necessary policy space in order to encourage investment in sectors that would eventually contribute towards the achievement of the sustainable development goal. The investment that is going to be sustainable in terms of creating employment opportunities, particularly for women, youth, marginalized and vulnerable communities. And it is going to be useful if it contributes to the environment objective that we are trying to achieve. It is going to be useful if it really contributes toward raising the standard of living of the people, including creating decent employment opportunity as indicated in the Goal 8. And I have a colleague from ILO who will probably shed light on this. So given this fact, what can a mechanism or a framework like EIF do in order to promote this kind of investment? I'll try to spend 2 minutes discussing about this. EIF as a framework was created to address trade-related challenges facing the country. The whole idea behind this initiative is that LDCs face critical challenges, supply-side constraint, because market access barrier is not a major barrier for them. In order to take advantage of the market access opportunities created through various mechanisms, including the multilateral and bilateral regional negotiation, it is an imperative that the supply-side constraint is addressed. And in order to address the supply-side constraint, what we try to do, and there the investment issue comes into play, is to prepare the analytical work at the country level. This analytical work, known as diagnostic trade integration study, are prepared at the country level. We have conducted more than 40 such diagnostic trade integration studies in LDCs. And these diagnostic trade integration studies have the component of investment there. They talk about the gap. They identify the gap in investment in sectors such as telecommunication, investment in sectors such as banking and finance, investment in sector that could directly affect the livelihood of the people, including agriculture. And based on these priorities, once these are identified, including the gaps in investment policy and regime, once these are identified, then on the basis of that, we create an institutional structure within the country to take forward the recommendations that have been provided through the analytical work. And there, the support is provided in a manner to create the institutional structure that is inclusive as well as efficient. We have what is known as National Steering Committee that steers the process, where we are now even thinking of having a representative from the investment promotion agencies within the country. And this is not something that we've done so far. Because the phase two of the EIF, which started this year, aims at bringing private sector in, because we need to leverage additional resources. Whatever resources that we provide to the countries are in the form of catalytic resources, and these are not going to solve the entire problem of the countries. So therefore, it is necessary to bring in private investment. Then the third thing that we do is to support specific projects that meets the requirement of the countries in terms of whether it is about addressing the capacity gap or meeting certain standards or reforming the trade facilitation regime, you know, including providing some kind of investment if that is required. So these are the examples of support we provide, including the promotion of agro enterprises in the country. With the help of the support that we have provided to agro enterprises in various countries, they have been able to use the support that we have provided as catalytic resources and have been able to generate additional private sector investment in a few countries. So That is what we try to do through the EIF. But you know, as we move into the as we moved into the second phase, we are trying to be more inclusive in terms of achieving the Sustainable Development Goal. And the entire lock frame of the EIF for phase two, the results framework, is aligned with the SDG. So whatever we do, you know, we try to contribute to some of the SDGs indicator, and definitely sustainable investment, you know, creation of environment that is conducive for the growth of sustainable investment is one of our objectives, and this is something that we would like to pursue vigorously in days to come. I'll probably stop there and will be happy to respond to any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Terrific. Thanks very much. Geeta Rowlands, what can we learn from the decent work deficits that the ILO has observed periodically? And how is the ILO working to help governments and companies address this? And if there are some specific illustrations of how this aspect of sustainable development is incorporated in investment contracts or deals or frameworks from the outset, it'd be interesting to hear about that as well. Over to you.
Well, thank you very much. I would like to start to say that I'm very happy to participate in these discussions. We do not very often come into the discussions on trade and investment, and so this is a really good opportunity. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the ILO, but I should say we are a specialized agency of the United Nations. We have 187 member states, including all of the LDCs, and so our mandate is decent work. From the outset, I think it's very interesting how the discussions actually are moving towards terminology like inclusive trade, sustainable investment, responsible supply chains, which actually means that the current practice is not inclusive, sustainable, or responsible, and that something needs to happen to come to a more equal sharing of the benefits of globalization. I think that's very clear. There are the discussions at all levels. And the Sustainable Development Goals, as already indicated by my colleague from the WTO, is clearly the framework that invites all of us to think about how trade and investment can actually contribute our tools to achieve these sustainable development goals. Now, why is this important for the ILO? First of all, because decent work is not only a specific SDG, namely SDG 8, where it is combined together with economic growth and productive employment, but secondly, because decent work is seen as a means to achieve overall sustainable development goals. So a contribution to poverty reduction, gender equality, elimination of child labor, forced labor, non-discrimination, and many of these other elements. So not only is it a goal in itself, but it's also a means to achieve more inclusive growth and sustainable development. Now, we also regularly consult the ILO constituents, and we are tripartite as an organization. So we go to the ministries of labor, we go to the trade unions, and we go to the employers' organizations of our member states. And as a follow-up mechanism to our instrument regarding multinational enterprises, we do every year a regional survey. Now, what comes out of that survey regarding foreign direct investment and M&Es is actually what those governments, employers, and workers want from investment and operations of multinational enterprises is the creation of employment, and not just any kind of employment, but decent work opportunities. They look for opportunities for skills development, so social upgrading in the country through business linkages with local enterprises. They look for local economic development and, of course, decent work working conditions. Now, the reality is that in many countries, this is not the automatic result of foreign direct investment or operations of multinational enterprises. So it's clear that something needs to happen. And what we also see from experiences at the country level is, of course, at the one hand, you have these national development priorities, you have decent work priorities in a country. And at the other hand, you have the policymakers more in the economic sphere, negotiating investment agreements, developing the investment policy, the trade policy, which are then not aligned with what the country wants to achieve as development priorities and decent work priorities. And in many cases, the incentives that are actually given to attract investors, and my other panelists already talked about this, of course, tax, for example, is one, but also limitations on freedom of association and collective bargaining in many areas to attract investors are actually contributing to a deficit of decent work and a deficit when you talk about inclusive growth and sustainable development. Because even when we talk about taxes, and I mean, it's not a topic that the ILO has a mandate to work on. But of course, when you look at taxes, and on the other hand, you were mentioning the need for public investment also, so the government preparing its workforce to be skilled workers so that when investors come in, invest in infrastructure, invest in all of these enabling environments in a way, you know, you need to ask yourself the question, where will these funds come from for the government? So they do need to have funds coming from those that have economic operations in their countries. If not, how will they have the resources to invest in skills development and education? So what we are working on very much is actually at the country level, what we see needs to happen. So there needs to be a closer alignment. And I think policy coherence was also a point that you see, but a closer alignment between the economic policymakers and the social policymakers in a country, so that decent work does not become, in a way, something that we think will automatically happen when investment and trade takes place in a country, but it is actually embedded from the start as an objective, that in job creation for young people, for women, for marginalized group and local economic development actually become the objective of investment and trade. For that, of course, governments need to put in place, at the one hand, regulation to protect workers from possible exploitation in their countries, but also an enabling environment for SME development, an enabling environment for skills development, and an enabling environment for access to finance. I mean, many of these elements in the enabling environment. And it also should specify clearly what are the expectations of investors when they come into the country. At the one hand, yes, you have the investment agreements, and a lot can be said about investment agreements and obligations in the investment agreements, but also what is actually expected in terms of inclusive, responsible, sustainable behavior from the investors and what they can actually do, even though legally they are not obliged to operate in a certain way, but what is actually expected from companies in today's societies in terms of their behavior? Is it maximization of profits, or is it actually contributing to the Sustainable Development Goals? Where again, you know, Sustainable Development Goal 17 clearly points towards partnerships with the private sector in achieving these Sustainable Development Goals. And then the whole area of social dialogue at a country level. Because where do you find a space at a country level where you bring all these different actors together to discuss the policies that need to be put in place? And how do you bring, for example, socio-economic councils in a country that are responsible to give advice to the country on issues related to socio-economic development? How do you bring them into the policy making on investment and trade? And we work a lot with socio-economic councils and other social dialogue institutions at the country level to, in a way, build up their capacities to better engage with these other ministries, but also to engage directly with investors on decent work priorities in the country. And then I would say a very important element is also evidence-based policymaking. So what do governments need to make policies that are actually based on evidence and not so much on slogans or on incentives, what other countries are doing, so we should do the same, but actually looking at what is currently the impact of multinational enterprises in my country on decent work. And if it is not giving, you know, are we monitoring actually what is the impact? Is it creating the jobs that we are looking for? Is it creating the linkages with the business national enterprises that we are looking for? And if it is not the case, then what should happen in terms of a different policy that we should put in place? Now, on all of these elements, the ILO provides support to our member states. And so at the country level, I do a lot of country level work as well in terms of tripartite plus dialogues linked to operations of multinational enterprises, but also with governments, employers, and trade unions to harness really the opportunities of foreign direct investment and trade for decent work. At the one hand, making sure or trying to mitigate and resolve possible negative impacts that we see happening, but also to fully harness opportunities of these trade and investment for decent work opportunities for the lots and lots of unemployed people around the world. And in a way, we do that, yes, by capacity building at a country level, but also by reaching out to the economic actors at the national level and the international level that are working in these areas. And for example, the organization with which we also have an MOU is UNCTAD, and they have their policy framework for sustainable investment, which is a policy framework that they work on with their member states, and that actually directly links to ILO standards, whether it's the fundamental principles and rights at work or the declaration we have on multinational enterprises. And that also allows us to actually closely work with them on these issues. Another one is that we are closely collaborating increasingly with investment promotion agencies, and they were already mentioned by two panelists, actually. And WIPA, the World Association of Investment Promotion Agency, actually reached out to the ILO because they want, with the investment promotion agencies, move on a track of attracting investment, yes, investment facilitation, but how do you attract the right kind of investment? The investment that indeed contributes to sustainable development goals, national development priorities, and decent work priorities. And with them, we are actually signing in 2 weeks' time in Istanbul during their World Investment Conference. We will be signing our cooperation agreement, and the ILO will also become part of their consultative committee, precisely because they want to build in far more the social dimension of attracting investment. And with them, we will be working on developing indicators that also investment promotion agencies can use when they attract investment and to closer align them with decent work. I think I will leave it here. I've probably taken up more than my 8 minutes, but I think we are really living in exciting times. There are many opportunities, and the Costa Rica case, of course, and I had the opportunity to listen to the case before. I think it's a very good example of how it really shows that when you have the right policies in place as a government, you can really benefit and harness these opportunities for decent work, for environmental sustainability, and for economic growth for the country. So it's not because you put these, I would say, expectations from the beginning also on investors, that it will have a negative impact on attracting investment. It will, on the contrary, provide more opportunities for the country to move on that path, bringing economic, social, and environmental dimensions of sustainability together. We also work directly with investors, with multinational enterprises, on their policies regarding human resources development and incorporating principles of international labor standards in CSR policies, procurement policies, and so on. I think after the discussion or the introduction by Unilever, we can also go further a little bit into that topic. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Now let's move to a very large multinational firm which has sustainability, I know, as one of the real strategic lodestars of the firm. So be interested to hear from you, Marcela Manubens. You're Global Vice President for Integrated Social Sustainability. What are some of the best practices that you have seen developing within your network over the years? And how do you think we could draw some lessons from your experience?
Thank you, Rick, and the panelists, and it is a pleasure for me to be here today to talk about this issue. I think that we pretty much established that trade is intimately linked to development, but not all trade brings about sustainable and responsible growth, economic growth. We simply need to look around the world for examples, and trade policy has such a profound impact on wealth generation and distribution. Such policies really provide the opportunity to lift, to create this virtuous cycle of growth. And the good news is that the world leaders agree on this. For the best part of the last decades, we have seen a serious and increasing focus on sustainability, the three angles of sustainability, economic, social, and environmental, and as well as the fundamental rights that Gita have outlined. We welcome the MDGs in the year 2000 that really start transforming the journey. Last year, we saw the passing of the SDGs that brought a renewed focus and commitment, real commitment, which was influenced and taken by government, business, and civil society. And when I think about rights, the International Bill of Rights, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the covenants, and I also think about the core conventions, the ILO core conventions. So there is consensus in the fundamental principles. We really have a significant amount of commitments that need now to be implemented. And actually, as I listen to all our presentations, it's quite a complex roadmap that we have developed. But we are at the point of risking to go long on commitments and go short on delivery. So I think that the work that you highlighted, Rick, in terms of the E15, the significant work that has been, you know, research that has been put in front of us, really that focus on effective implementation, and two words you said really resonated with me. One was the declutter, the other the modernizing, the modernization of the frameworks that we have, and the other that was throughout is the simplification. We need to make it work, and it needs to be simple, but it has to be really aligned and not what I call often my Jackson Pollock painting, different initiatives, but be a cohesive, really, picture. So at Unilever, we do have a point of view. In year 2010, we launched what we call the Unilever Sustainable Living Plan, and with three very big block ambitions. That is health and well-being, the environmental footprint and the social angle, which is enhancing livelihoods. The USLP for us embodies our formula, if you would, for responsible and sustainable capitalism is the way that we want to do business. And we set clear targets under each one of those ambitions to really deliver by 2020. And we have now recently also explained the complexities of really reaching our targets from environmental point of view. After 3 years in 2000, in the year 2014, we expanded the USLP. We did, you know, we looked, we reflected, we learned the lessons that we said, you know, in our social element, you know, we need to expand. And we created three distinctive pillars, what we call in that strategy. One is fairness in the workplace. It's all about human rights. And it's all about many of the things that Gita have been outlining and the other panelists. The second pillar is opportunity for women. It's all about women's empowerment. As Kofi Annan famously said, you know, there is no tool more effective for development than women's empowerment. And we can see that throughout the research and work that it has been done. And the third pillar is inclusive business. And inclusive business means that model, and we focus in the vulnerable and most needed actions, such as working with smallholder farmers, smaller scale retailers, and also youth. For me, the USLP is the framework that helps us transform ourselves internally, that helps us think about what we need to do. Each element of the USLP, we can trace it back to an SDG. Whether it's decent work or women's empowerment or these collaborations, I mean, each one of those components and targets is linked. And if you think about, I mean, how can we rethink business? If we press a magic button and we said we wake up tomorrow, all the companies in the world have models that are sustainable and responsible, how would that look like? And you need to go from the beginning of times, from the conception of a product, of a design, of a development, to the way that you manage your supply chain, that you source, that you distribute, that you sell, and the consumer use your products cradle to cradle. Responsible supply chains, it was an area that particularly of interest for us to talk. In 2014, we launched what we call the responsible sourcing policy. And basically, you know, many companies operating all over the world, everybody has a supplier code. And it's famously all of them anchored in core foundational principles like the ones that Gita have outlined, ILO core conventions, you know, the principles of decent work, legal considerations, etc. But if you look into those code of conducts, look perfect, but in reality, you cannot match, the reality. So when we created the responsible sourcing policy, we have some fundamental principles. We wanted to move from do no harm to do good. If you think about, much of the work that we are doing is in do no harm, do not engage with child labor, do not discriminate, do not harass. And once that you get done with that, I mean, how good looks like? So that's where we start. We say that's our compass. We know that from now, from where you look into supply chains around the world, from where we are to where we need to go, there is a lot of do no harm that we need to tackle. But we need to have a clear vision of where we are going. And that's what that document and that tool and mindset created for us. It created a continuous improvement ladder. I mean, there is this perception that you need to do it overnight. It's not going to happen. And if you don't tackle the root causes and understand why certain issues are taking place, and many times is anchored in practices that we have set up even in our own trade agreements, right, from the beginning of times. So if we don't tackle those root causes, we are not going to get the job done. And one element that at Unilever, I mean, I came to Unilever in 2013. I tell in a little bit about my journey. But we really think that this is, as it was said before, it cannot be done by one company or one government. You know, we need to work it out together. And because we have different expertise, and we can come together to the table, but we need to align and we need to make sure that we can develop those mechanisms. Really, finding solutions to address these systemic human and labor rights abuses are at the core of what we need to do. So our chief supply chain officer, it was interesting because Rick mentioned two titles for me. I started life at Unilever 3 years ago as the Global VP for Social Impact. Basically, my focus was to wire the organization to address many of the things I'm talking about. But this year we said, you know, our new chief supply chain officer, who is a fantastic, you know, really understands the issues, created a new role that is this integrated social sustainability, you know, role. Integrated because it's all about embedded. It cannot be just someplace out there. It has to be at the core of our business decisions. And social sustainability, because I still feel that when we go around and we talk about sustainability, we are focusing about environment. And environment has a human face. You know, famously, Mary Robinson has been focusing her body of work on that. Our focus in this role is really to embed, to be at the core where the decision processes start, to really help that transformation that we all want to have, and really use innovation and working together, collaboration. Now, anybody who has collaborated in an agenda, and all of us, know how difficult that is. You know, I heard the other day someone saying a good day in the office is when you have a good alignment, particularly in today's world. And it was said in this multi-stakeholder, you know, group, and I agree. So there is a lot of work that it needs to be done to really simplify that process and really bring more agility to what we need to do. So demonstrating the business case on this, building new models, my experience during many years shows that in many times these things are not done, not because people are corrupt or they don't want to implement or because they want to manipulate. It's just they simply do not know. I mean, in many of these issues, we need to really, when we tackle root causes, we need to really come up with a different, more refreshed approach. And capacity building and understanding that is critical for us. So I personally, you know, and professionally have a point of view. My own experience, you know, have been in what I call the global playground. The accent, I started life in Argentina. Then my professional, you know, moved to U.S. because of a scholarship, and my professional career has been there. I guess what I'm known is for having created one of the first global human rights programs in the fashion apparel industry. And if you go back to 1991 when I started doing that, I mean, the world looked different. We didn't have the transparency that we have today. We didn't have the technology. We didn't have many of the, and we committed, you know, at that point, everybody throughout, you know, because of lack of information, but there were many issues that we needed to tackle. So we have improved since then. But I think that for me, it has always been about the business model and the supply chains and bringing, you know, that transformation that we need to have. And you know, Ambassador, you reminded me, you know, that back then in the 90s, I remember particularly coming from Latin America, and in Latin America and Central America, there were, you know, the trade, you know, incentive was the fact that there were no really well-established and decent work organizations. There were no civil society. There were no unions. There were no taxes. You know, come to my country, invest, because that was the trade tool to attract, to bring incentives. And I think that when I hear the panelists and, you know, so eloquently talk about what are those tools, how we have changed that is really instrumental. And even the consistency within a very short, you know, geographic region. I remember three legislations. You have pregnancy testing as requirement for employment in one country. In the other was prohibited, and in the other country, you know, the legislation remained silent. So you think about how that legislation and the alignment is influencing investment, business decisions, and the work that is done in that country. So I think that is important to do. So what does all of this mean? I mean, what does it mean in real life? I mean, how do we materialize all these frameworks? I mean, what is that it can that we can do? And I thought about a few examples to give you that I was intimately, you know, involved on. One is Bangladesh. Come from the apparel industry. We all know, you know, we have seen Rana Plaza and many, you know, poor health and safety conditions that resulted in the loss of many, many lives. at the beginning of time, as the industry in the 90s was created in that country, there was no consideration to issues of health and safety. I was responsible for the MOU that was signed with my prior employer and a few NGOs and organizations and unions in the country to really set up the basis and to kick off the safety program that then gave birth to the Accord and the Alliance. There were not too many companies, you know, the companies were talking, but they were scared about doing that. Certainly no engagement within the country. And when you look into that situation, you have international actors, trade agreements, free trade agreements, you have private sector, governmental officials. So you have, you know, a whole setup that needs to get engaged to deliver on that. MSI, the multi-stakeholder initiative platforms, is the way to go when you need to have that kind of transformation. Look into many years, 2006, I think it was, forced labor exposé in Jordan. And I think that this is particularly important for today because the free trade agreement signed between U.S. and Jordan in year 2000, you know, provided the foundation for that industry. And it was a significant due diligence on labor and conditions that it was done at the beginning of times. And it was the assessment resulted that conditions were prevailed, you know, to establish the industry and provide those beneficial, you know, trade conditions. But there was one element that it was probably not taken into consideration so much, and it was the fact that there wasn't a ready workforce in that country. So when you have that situation, you have one of two things. Either you bring labor from another country to that to operate the industry or to train, or you build the internal capacity. So I think that we all knew that there was a significant, you know, number of exposés on that. And
why don't we proceed to comments from the audience, perhaps? If you can
okay.
Wrap up relatively quickly.
Okay. I think that I'm extending myself. That's what it is. Okay.
Very, very interesting, though, that some of the both the frameworks as well as the concrete illustrations, much, much appreciated. I think we could all learn a lot from Unilever's practices and really a strategic evolution over the years. I know it's raised some questions in my mind, but what we'd like to do is to use the remaining 20 minutes that we have here to open up the session to you in the audience if you have a question. Or you would like to see an issue treated a little bit more deeply that's come up in the discussion thus far, if you could home in relatively quickly on your point or your question. And as you do so, could you just simply identify yourself, your name and your affiliation? That'd be much appreciated. So would anyone like to be recognized? No? Okay. Let me perhaps ask a question or so. So we've heard a diversity of perspectives about what you might think of as the ingredients of a more sustainable model, sustainable in many dimensions of investment. And this session is very much oriented toward the developing countries. This is about inclusive growth, and I think it's reasonably fair to say that FDI and international value chains are relatively concentrated in a subset of developing countries. They're not really widely permeated inclusively throughout the entire world economy, particularly throughout developing countries in general. And I guess I would ask my colleagues here, I mean, both from the corporate side who have the practice as well as some of the agencies who are there to support, if you are a developing country government or business, I mean, how do you navigate this maze? I mean, for example, can I ask whether the ILO, your program, and the integrated framework, have you ever worked together before? Do you ever go in and have a sort of an integrated approach to helping the governments? Is there a place where best practice of the type that we've heard about here is captured well enough so that there's a relatively low transaction cost way for a country that's trying to figure out both its overall framework for inviting investment in, but also as they embark upon negotiations to get both the capacity on the one hand and the good practice in terms of their frameworks on the other reasonably easily. Maybe let me ask that to that question to my colleagues, and then maybe I'll follow up on that.
Do you want to respond first?
Okay, so I will try to at least bring some elements to this quite complex question. First of all, I think there is a kind of recognition that many developing countries, in a way, are in competition to mm-hmm. attract investment. Not taking into account natural resources, which are in a country or they are not, you know. So, I mean, that besides that. But when you look at countries trying to attract investment that will create jobs by developing a manufacturing or services, so how do they go about it to make sure that indeed it will create the jobs and lead to this social upgrading for them as well, creating more opportunities? Well, I think in general, they try to give as many incentives as possible to the investors, meaning that from the origin, there are a number of elements that are not really conducive then for this inclusive growth. So what we have been working on in a number of countries is actually how to build the capacity of the government that is indeed trying to attract this investment to, from the beginning, put job creation, and especially for young people, if that is such an important priority for the country, to actually put that up front in their negotiations and dialogues with new investors coming into the country. So that it is a very important element. And we are developing, I mean, in one particular country in Africa, we are actually providing support for them with a very large new investor coming into the country to make sure that they hire, they skill the young people, and there are linkages with national enterprises. But in terms of the collaboration, which was another, we collaborate with UNCTAD and we get increasingly the requests from UNCTAD, for example, also on investment policy reviews, whether ILO could be part of that to increase that social dimension when they do the policy investment review. And as I said, in terms of working with the investment promotion agencies, that's definitely where we want to go. But I think it's very important from the outset.
But the country's got to find you, presumably, or you go knock on their door.
Well, we have...
Wondering, you know, is there a more efficient way to roll this up so that countries know where to find not only what the ILO can provide, but the capacity building that might be in different places, the practices over here, the learnings from the successful developing countries? Ambassador, it'd be interesting to get your perspective. You work with a lot of your colleagues here in the WTO. What's their perspective about what could be helpful in the international community to facilitate a wider distribution of FDI around the world among developing countries? What can you provide a perspective as to what they think would be most helpful in this regard?
I think the answer to this question has many approaches. So the one thing I'm going to say is that an organization like the WTO, for example, for the matter, UNCTAD or ITC or even the OECD, what they do is that they show a scenario of a best practice or how things should look like in order to achieve certain degrees of development within specific constraints. And then it is up to the countries to domestically adopt whichever policies they believe are more suitable for their needs. Now, this process, as you just remarked on what Gita had just said, is difficult to make in a consistent way. Do we have to come all the way here to see this picture, or can you come to us to show us the picture. And then once the picture is shown, are we going to do something about it? So it's very difficult. I think it's something that works in a case by case method. I think regionally, some countries are in better positions to illustrate to their neighbors some of these best practices once they've been adopted, like the example of Dubai that Kruti has shared with us. I think Dubai has had this ripple effect in mm-hmm. the region. So yeah, there are many angles to this question.
Can I ask one? Thank you very much. This is a valid question. What I would like to mention is that EIF particularly focuses on trade side. Investment has not been treated in a structured manner, although in bits and pieces we have treated investment issues such as through the analytical work, the DTIS itself. And by the way, when we are talking about DTIS and talking about the coherence and focus intervention to avoid duplication and maximizing synergy, this is precisely what EIF is doing. Due to lack of time, I couldn't go into the details of how we sort of implement the program on the ground. And what is the partnership structure in place. We are a partnership between the World Trade Organization, UNDP, World Bank, IMF, UNCTAD, and ITC. These are the institutions that created us in order to apply the capacity building efforts on a more focused and coherent manner at the country level, particularly focusing on LDCs, realizing that they didn't have the capacity. So investment, treating investment as a sort of a new issue in a more structured manner is something that we can definitely look into. And Geeta mentioned about the collaboration with WIPA. We are also collaborating with the World Association of Investment Promotion Agencies, and we are also participating in the conference that they are organizing. So we have established that kind of collaboration already, and we are trying to sort of convince them to move in the direction of sustainable development, investment. But what is I think required in the case of LDCs is not only a focused intervention and coherent intervention, but also to help them to identify their own constraint and help them on capacity building in terms of policy making, in terms of designing the rules that they would be able to apply in practice in order to enhance their capacity to implement the rule that they have designed themselves, in order to build their capacity to monitor and follow up on the on the implementation practices. At the end of the day, what is required, I will go back to the previous point that I made, is that for the last 30 years we have moved in the era of race to the bottom. Mm-hmm. In terms of promotion of investment, any investment is good. But now we have to move, and this is a concerted effort that we have to make, and for which I would like to sort of invite support from all of us here to the race to the bottom, from the race to the bottom to race to the top. And this race to the top will be, where we will be talking about. In this scenario, where we will be talking about investment, both public and private, contributing to the achievement of sustainable development goal and being more inclusive and more sustainable than they have been before. Because at the end of the day, it is necessary for the private sector. I think they have realized this also, to understand that if you do not have the peace and security that is necessary for us to continue to function in this world, if you do not have the environment and resources that is necessary for us to function in this world, if we do not have the workers that are productive enough, through the decent working environment or opportunity that is provided to them, and the minimum wage that is provided to them that will take care of their families and children, health and education requirement, then where will the private sector invest? I'll probably stop there.
Okay. Maybe back to you, Marcella. The race to the top, you called it do good, not just do no harm. You've developed a wealth of practice. Presumably, you monitor and measure how well that performance is within your supply chains. Mm-hmm. But very few companies have put in the time, the experience, the resources into such activity that, that yours has. What's a way to help to disseminate that? I mean, are there good collection of best practice available in this regard? Is there a well-recognized metric for what constitutes a good responsible supply chain practice? If not, what do you have any suggestions as to how the international community could enable, that's the topic of the session today, enable such sustainable types of investment behavior?
I think that in terms of metric, Rick, I think that, we have put a lot of effort. I have put, particularly in my area of work on social metrics, a lot of effort, but because we think that is part of doing business. It's not just for the good of it. It's not for reporting and demonstrating to others that we are doing something. It's just to really measure our performance, to see the impact that we have. And there is a series of, there's far too many metrics. And if I were to have it today, I would say, you know, let us focus on triple bottom line, let us, or share value, let us keep it simple, let us agree on how do we measure this, you know, with one metric and simplify. I heard today from Gita that from the multinational, corporations, you have a set of tools that she is developing as well. So I think that in this case, is keep it simple and can we start aligning? So when we look into the work that we do, when we measure business and deliver it to community, we can measure in the same way. And there is a significant amount of tools, you know, that, for the development for the SDGs, they are currently, you know, a series of metrics that are being rolled out. Sort of linking your prior question to this question, I just want to, because, Mr. Adhikari, you were so succinct in putting it, I think it's terrific. But I just want to highlight that you cannot build capacity in terms of where a government or it stands for. And I think that it becomes worse with the, changes of government. And probably you asked before, Rick, what would it be important? One of the cases that I have seen to be very practical was in the case of Cambodia and the fact that there was child labor and they needed to resolve the issue and they have an industry. And the government of Cambodia was very clear. He said, we have no appetite for companies coming and using this as a trade tool. The Better Work program that is very practical. You heard Gita talking about frameworks and all that, but when you go to that in on the ground program, it was terrific. It had real, real impact. So I think that I want to highlight that because the metrics are important, but we need to first be clear in where we stand and what is that that they go. And I think that for me, the race to the top that Mr. Adhikari has been mentioning in and the strongest stand that translation into trade is critical.
Terrific. We've just about reached the end of our time. I think each of our panelists have had a chance to make a last comment, except for you. Kruti, would you like to offer a last thought before I wrap up the session and close it?
It was very interesting listening to everyone's perception. I personally believe that we are embarking on a very long journey. What is happening in all the countries at the moment is right. There needs to be an alignment between the World Trade Organization, the EIF, along with the policies which are being introduced in different countries, and these policies need to be implemented. And I personally feel that the next decade, the next 10 years, is going to see a huge advancement in the way the countries are structuring their policies. At the end of the day, an economy means people, and people run the economy. So it's very important for the country and for each country and for all the global platforms to encourage all the countries to introduce policies which would be conducive for the economy of the country. And when I say economy of the country, it would mean the people, the companies, the private sector, as well as the public sector.
Right. Thank you. I hope you've benefited from the discussion. I think I certainly have. Maybe just a final note to bring it back to what's going to happen next in this regard. I mentioned earlier that we have a dialogue process to look at the normative side, how the normative aspect of international investment can be updated, modernized, and infused with a greater degree of focus on sustainable development. Then on the facilitative side, I just note two things for you. Well, maybe just one, given the shortness of time, and that is that the World Economic Forum and the World Bank now are working in a partnership to develop a better crystallization of good practice as to what constitutes inclusive corporate practice, and particularly in supply chains in developing countries. And secondly, to think about whether we can pull together a common view among the various experts, whether they be practicing companies or organizations that have developed frameworks for the metrics for how you monitor and measure and communicate progress in this regard. And we're doing that as a, if you will, a prelude to seeing whether it might be possible to take and implement one of the E15's important proposals in this area. And that is, given what I said earlier about the relative geographical concentration of international value chains in a limited number of developing countries, whether it might be possible to help reduce the complexity of navigating this world for developing countries by creating a so-called global value chain partnership that would, if you will, provide in a single framework, a platform, if you will, which will be a network of key organizations, the ability to understand what are cutting edge or good frameworks for engaging investors. Secondly, what's the best learning as to how a country extracts the maximum payoff for sustainable development from an open investment policy? What are the learnings from some of their peer countries like Costa Rica and others? And thirdly, getting a better understanding by direct engagement of the private sector as to what is the pathway right now of these value chains? Where are they active? Where are they not? What are the policy or other bottlenecks and impediments that impede the broader extension of those value chains into new geographies? And then finally, right back to facilitation, by having this expertise from various sources distilled and coordinated in a way so that you lower the very difficult navigation challenges that many countries find, to use that, since you've got the private sector, you've got the academics, and you've got other key institutions involved that have capacity building resources, use it as a platform for actually facilitating direct discussions between countries and a wider set of companies that may have an appetite in expanding investment. Again, we call that in the E15 a global value chain partnership. It's a more structured attempt, a structured vision, I would say, at this point, is to try to enable sustainable investment for inclusive growth, and that's the reason why we frame this. That is the topic of today's session. I thank you all for participating. I thank, in particular, our panelists here, and I would ask you to join me in giving them a warm round of applause for their contributions today. And thanks very much to my colleagues, Francesca Bianchi and Christian Rodriguez-Schiffel, for organizing this session today. I hope you have a good day here at the WTO. Bye-bye.